Charles S. Howard, Seabiscuit missed the next big cap because of an injury, but was brought back in 1940 to challenge the 1939 winner, his own stablemate, Kayak II, and 11 other runners. Seabiscuit carried 130 pounds and Kayak 129 as a crowd of 68,000 watched.
Coming down the stretch the first time, it's Whitsea in front between Specify and Seabiscuit. Seabiscuit on the outside is second by a neck. Specify on the rail is third by a neck. Royal Crusader on the outside is fourth by a half a length. Wedding Call is fifth by 2.5 lengths. And Don Mike, Mike County is next, and Ra. Into the back stretch is Whitsea in front by one length. Royal Crusader is second by a head. Seabiscuit is third by a head. Wedding Call is fourth on the extreme outside by 3 lengths. Specify is fifth by a length and 1/2, and Vi County is sixth. Around the far turn, it's Whitsea going to a drive by 3/4 of a length. Seabiscuit is second by a head. Wedding Call is third, and England Can't Wait. They're turning for home now with the Wedding Call in front by a head. Kayak is second by a head. Seabiscuit is third by 1 length. And by County into the stretch, it's Seabiscuit in front by a head. Kayak on the outside is second. It's Kayak and Seabiscuit head in hand. It's Seabiscuit on the rail. Seabiscuit and Kayak. Seabiscuit and Kayak. They're coming down there, and Seabiscuit. Seabiscuit wins it. A new world champion comes down there. He wins it. And listen to the crowd. All by himself. Seabiscuit by 2. Kayak is second by 1.
Seabiscuit reached the pinnacle of his career that day, setting a track record of 2:01 1/5. He was retired after the race as the world's leading money winner with earnings of $437,730. Known as well in the West as across the country, the Gallant Bay horse even inspired Hollywood. The story of Seabiscuit starred Shirley Temple, Barry Fitzgerald, and Lon McAllister on the silver screen.
Early in the summer meeting at Hollywood Park, handicap horses from all over the country gathered to compete in the first $100,000 race at the track of the Lakes and Flowers, the Californian. Carrying the top impost of 130 pounds was perhaps the best horse in training at that moment in the land, Dr. Fager, trained by flamboyant John Nerud. It was noted at post time that no horse had ever carried 130 pounds to victory in this race, with Swaps, Roundtable, Pruvit, and Kelso among the good ones defeated at one time or another. 14 thoroughbreds went postward. They're all in the gate, and here is Harry Henson to call the Californian.
And there they go. Dr. Roy E. is going to the front. Kissin' George is second, moving up on the inside. Dr. Fager, third on the outside. Rising Market is fourth. Barb's Delight, fifth. Fieldmaster, sixth. Then Sand Devil, Our Michael. Traffic Charger, Proud Land on the inside. Zulu Lad, Aurelius, and Lucky Bush around the turn. It's Kissin' George in front, drawing out by 2 lengths. Rising Market is second by a head. Dr. Roy E. third by a length and a half. Dr. Fager fourth by a length and a half. Barb's Delight is fifth. Fieldmaster sixth. Sand Devil, Our Michael, Gamely, and Proud Land going into the fire turn. There goes Dr. Fager moving up on the inside. It's still Kissin' George in front on the outside by a neck. Dr. Fager is second on the rail by a length and a half. Rising Market third by a neck. Dr. Roy E. fourth by 4 lengths. Barb's Delight is fifth. Gamely sixth. Our Michael and Fieldmaster around the turn. It's Dr. Fager in front on the rail by a head. Kissin' George is second by 2.5 lengths. Rising Market third by a length. Dr. Roy E. is fourth. Barb's Delight fifth, and Gamely turning into the stretch. It's Dr. Fager in front by 3/4 of a length. Kissin' George is second by 1 length. Barb's Delight third. Gamely is fourth. And Rising Market, Aurelius pulled up. It's Dr. Fager in front by 2.5 lengths. Gamely is second. Rising Market third. And Barb's Delight. Dr. Fager in front. Gamely and Rising Market. And Dr. Fager is the winner by 3 lengths. Gamely second by a length with Rising Market finishing third.
Breaking the 130-pound jinx with apparent ease, Dr. Fager, number 9, flew in on Thursday, raced Saturday, and left Sunday, $74,600 richer.
Spectacular Bid was a true superstar, a flashy gray colt. Trainer Buddy Delp won the Kentucky Derby and the Preakness Stakes with his three-year-old champ in 1979 and would have added the Belmont Stakes to complete the coveted Triple Crown if not for a disastrous ride by young jockey Ronnie Franklin. Buddy said that Spectacular Bid was the best horse ever to look through a bridle. That boast was ridiculed back in 1979, but the farther away we get, the more in focus Spectacular Bid becomes. He was special. Maybe Delp was right. With Hall of Famer Bill Shoemaker aboard, Spectacular Bid closed out the year with a record-breaking run in the 1979 Meadowlands Cup.
In the final furlong, Spectacular Bid. In front now by two, Valdez second and Smart 10 third. It's Spectacular Bid with Bill Shoemaker aboard. Spectacular Bid wins the Meadowlands Cup.
But the most amazing American-trained winner of the Breeders' Cup Mile was also perhaps the most unlikely in the championship series' great history. It's the horse. A $6,000 yearling who had to overcome a torn hoof and a mysterious hind leg lameness to become a Breeders' Cup champion. Not once, but twice. Owned by Prestonwood Farm and Wall Street Racing Stable and trained by the transplanted Englishman Michael Dickinson, the horse had tried the Breeders' Cup sprint in 1995 and ran last of 13. Now, in 1996 in the mile, the horse was up against the full field of 14 runners, including the European superstar Mark of Esteem and a future mile champion Spinning World.
On the outside, urgent request is right there. The horse sitting in just in behind the lead. He's running in third. Chaposa Springs is now fourth. Spinning World fifth on the outside. Mark of Esteem is still in behind horses as they make the turn into this towering stretch here at Woodbine. It's Kiragachi, and the horse is coming to Kiragachi. Urgent request is nothing left. Spinning World is right there. And on the far outside, Mark of Esteem has still got a lot to do. It's the American, the horse with the two-length lead. Spinning World trying to reel him in as they come down to the finish. But the victory goes to the horse in the mile. He won by a length and a half. Spinning World was second. And Santa Wish came on to be third.
The horse had become a Breeders' Cup champion, and his legend would continue to grow. But first, there were more setbacks. He missed all of 1997, never getting to the track because of problems with his tendons and fetlocks. But in 1998, at age six, the horse finally was back in training and a real challenge for his trainer, Michael Dickinson.
It's been an emotional roller coaster, but Joan and I don't have any children, and our horses are our children. And no father could be prouder of his son than I am of the horse. And Joan, you know, no mother could be prouder. I mean, our horses are our boys and girls. And I suppose because we love him so much.
Dickinson bought the horse into the Breeders' Cup Mile off a two-year layoff and a single prep race, an allowance race at Colonial Downs in Virginia. Could he, would he be ready to take on 13 of the best turf milers in the world off just that one race? The crowd of more than 80,000 at Churchill Downs bet 11-1 against him. But they would soon be cheering the horse.
On the outside, Cape Cross, a short lead among men toward the inside. Reigning horse of the year, favorite trick is right there. And Pat Day is moving his favorite trick. As they approach the top of the stretch, they are in front, the short lead. Flight of the Stars is just in behind them, and a host of pursuers are coming on. The horse is in with the chance on the outside. Second Empire, Hawksley Hill is now coming hard. Labib is finding his best start late. Triadus on the outside, nothing left for favorite trick. It is the horse and Hawksley Hill. Hawksley Hill and the horse. Hawksley Hill forges a short lead. The horse is game as they come. Coming down to the line. Spine tingling stretch line. The horse comes back. Unbelievable. Sensational. In victory here today. Very, very close with Hawksley Hill. Oh, my. This is the greatest comeback since Lazarus.
The horse on the rail wins his second Breeders' Cup championship by a head over Hawksley Hill. The replay shows that in mid-stretch, Hawksley Hill actually put his head in front. But the horse, under his new rider, John Velasquez, re-rallied to get to the wire first. The amazing De Hoss, out of racing for almost 2 years, with just an allowance prep race on his past performance line in 1998, wins the Breeders' Cup Mile for the second time in his career. That race would be his last. De Hoss would never race again, but he didn't have to, because forevermore, he'll be a Breeders' Cup legend.
This is only the fourth time in Charismatic's racing career that he has gone off as the favorite. Mike Pagram, who last year had Real Quiet, but this year, Silver Bullet Day. Elliot Walden, who watched his horse, Menifee, try to spoil the party. The crowd in full throat right now as the horses load into the starting gate. And for the call of the Belmont, Dave Johnson.
Mile and a half, a fast track, a field of 12, all three-year-olds. The filly carries 5 pounds less than the colts, 121 for Silver Bullet Day, the others 126. And Lemon Drop Kid is giving him a little bit of trouble trying to get into the starting gate right now. There goes Patience Game. Wayne Lucas.
Jeff.
Wayne Lucas and Bob Lewis. Adonis. Bob Baffert, the trainer of Silver Bullet Day. Menifee second in the Derby and the Preakness. And his trainer, Elliot Walden, the jockey, is Pat Day.
Two out. Still got one out. Got one out.
That one is best of luck. He's in line. We're ready for the start. And they're off in the Belmont Stakes, and Best of Luck was off a step slowly, as was Pineapp, and Charismatic gets away cleanly as they run to the first turn. Menifee surprisingly on the outside, along with Stephen Got Even showing early speed. Charismatic and the filly, Silver Bullet Day, at the rail. They're at the clubhouse turn, and it's Silver Bullet Day with the red cap leading it, and the Derby winner on the outside. It's Charismatic now putting ahead in front. It's the lady and the champ up front. Charismatic on the outside, and Silver Bullet Day races in the second spot. On the outside with the red color, Stephen Got Even is in third position. Moving through on the inside, that's Vision and Verse as they race down the backstretch. The first quarter was in 23-3. They straighten away for the run down the backstretch. And it's Silver Bullet Day on the inside in front by a head. Charismatic going for the Triple Crown is second. And Stephen Got Even inching up on the outside third. Prime Directive with the red blinkers is fourth. And along the inside, Vision and Verse is fifth at this point. Then comes Menifee, who has been shuffled back into sixth position. Lemon Drop Kid is next. After that, it's Patience Game. Teletable, two and a half back to Adonis. And far back, it's Best of Luck. And far, far back, and having lost touch with the field, Pinehead. They go to the far turn. And Silver Bullet Day leads it by half a length easily. Jerry Bailey aboard. Charismatic is second. And on the outside, Stephen Got Even. And just behind those in the black cap, Vision and Verse, saving ground on the inside as they reach the midway point on the turn. Adonis is fifth at this point. Lemon Drop Kid is sixth. Menifee is seventh as they move to the top of the stretch. It's the filly, Silver Bullet Day, on the rail in front. Between horses, Charismatic trying for the Triple Crown. On the outside, Stephen Got Even. Adonis, and here on the extreme outside comes Lemon Drop Kid. At the rail, in the white blinkers, Vision and Verse. Now five of them, and Charismatic takes the lead. Charismatic between horses, but on the outside, there goes Lemon Drop Kid just rushing to contention. Lemon Drop Kid, and on the inside, Vision and Verse. Lemon Drop Kid on the outside, Vision and Verse. Charismatic is beaten. Here's the finish. It's going to be tight. Lemon Drop Kid, I believe, held on to win it by a head. Trained by Scotty Schulhofer. Ridden ridden by Jose Santos on the inside, Vision and Burst. It's a photo finish. Alberto Castillo Jr. finishing in the photo finish. Charismatic denied the triple crown. The final time, 2 minutes, 27 and 4/5 seconds, and Charismatic is pulling up, and that's Chris Antley off, and he's holding Charismatic's leg. Bob Lewis, the owner there, and Chris, and just behind, Wayne Lucas, the trainer.
Taking their positions for the 17th running of the Breeders' Cup Classic. Gander is moved into line. And the favorite here is Derby winner Fusaichi Pegasus, 6-5 on the tote board here at Churchill Downs. Tis now moving into his post position. And on the outside, Giant's Causeway up to take post position number 14. Giant's Causeway balking just a bit behind the starting gate as he makes his first start in America. In fact, his first start on the dirt. Winner of five straight Grade One races in Europe this year. The hope of Ireland, the Iron Horse, as he's called over there. Walking just a bit in behind the starting gate. The others loaded quite comfortably. And Giant's Causeway in no particular hurry to get into the starting gate today. He's rather rambunctious. He tends to be a little hot and act this way in his races. He's done this in previous races before, and he is really a handful for the assistant starters here at Churchill Downs. What they'll try to do is move around behind him, clasp their hands behind, and perhaps a little extra urging to get into the starting gate. And Donna, what's it look like from your point of view? I'm a quarter of a mile away from him.
They're getting ready to put the red blindfold on him that you saw in Calanese earlier, and that was a good sign for Calanese. Hopefully it'll get him in. They've had five guys behind him trying to push him into the gate, but he keeps kicking them away from him, so they're not able to get behind him and just push him. But right now they have the blindfold on him. They'll probably try to take a couple of laps around just to confuse him and disorient him a little bit, and then try to take a run at the gate again, where he has a little less indication which way he's headed. You can see again now they're trying to get behind him and lock holds of their hands behind his rear end to push him in, but every time they try to do that, he just kicks at him. I think right now they have the entire starting gate crew pushing him into the gate. There he goes. Well, almost.
Giant's Causeway just about in the starting gate. The blindfold has been applied. Soon to take it off. Blindfold off, ready to start the 17th running of the Breeders' Cup Classic. And they're off. Lemon Drop Kid has some speed today. Golden Missile toward the inside. Cat Thief, Captain Steve down toward the rail. Here comes Tisdow from the far outside. So they pass us for the first time. It's Cat Thief and Albert the Great now. Albert the Great comes on through to be the early pacemaker. Tisdow, second on the outside, pressing the pace. Lemon Drop Kid is there. Giant's Causeway is going to get caught four wide going into the turn. Vision and Burst is fifth between horses. Cat Thief is sixth toward the inside. Golden Missile going wide into the turn. There was a little traffic trouble there for Guided Tour. Fusaichi Pegasus is seventh at this juncture. He's about six lengths for the lead. Gander to his outside. And Fusaichi Pegasus is moving early. Near the back of the pack, Pine Dance three wide, a length and a half back to Captain Steve, and another five to late running Dust on the Bottle. The opening quarter goes at 23 2/5 seconds, and it's Tisdow and Albert the Great. And the 2 3-year-olds in tandem down the back stretch after a solid opening half of 47 and 2/5 seconds. Ireland's Giant's Causeway on the outside third. And then it's Vision and Burst, who is in between horses. Lemon Drop Kid toward the inside, the Grey Gander. Fusaichi Pegasus is still about six lengths from the lead with 4 furlongs remaining. Captain Steve has moved the opening toward the inside. Golden Missile, Cat Thief, last year's winner, has dropped off the pace now. And then it's Pine Dance as the field rounds the far turn. Albert the Great and Tisdow, they continue to go at it. Giant's Causeway is called on for his run. Lemon Drop Kid is fourth toward the inside. Gander is fifth. Vision and Burst is sixth. Fusaichi Pegasus is toiling. The field comes off the turn. Tisdow on the outside. Albert the Great on the rail. The two of them continue to go at it. Here comes Giant's Causeway for Ireland on the outside. They're coming into the final furlong. Tisdow tough as nails. Giant's Causeway on the outside. Giant's Causeway and Tisdow battling head to head. A heart pounding, pulsating stretch drive. And Tisdow
Ichi Pegasus ran an uninspiring race today, finishing in the middle of the pack. And the final time here was 2 minutes and 3/5 of a second. Tom Thank Hammond, you. Back to you. Another thrilling redol of the Breeders' Cup Classic.
And there's a look at Point Given and Gary Stevens as they approach the starting gate. And a look at Dollar Bill, ridden by Pat Day, riding in his 18th consecutive Derby. That is a record. So they're starting to load into the gate for the Derby. Over a mile and a quarter, they all carry 126 pounds. Grade one race with $1,112,000. The total purse, $812,000 to the winner. And the first leg of the Visa Triple Crown. And to call the Kentucky Derby, Tom Durkin is high atop the stands here at Churchill Downs. Tom, what will you look for at the start of the Derby?
Well, at the start, I'm going to be looking at a few horses, particularly the first three from post positions 1, 2, and 3. Often in the Kentucky Derby, there's a lot of bumping coming out of those starting gates. Song and a Prayer, Millennium Wind, and Balto Star all have a lot of speed, so that'll be very key for them in the beginning. And then along with all of the favorite players at Churchill Downs and around the country, around the world, in fact, to be looking at post position number 17 for the favorite Point Given. Keats goes into position number 14. He's expected to deliver a lot of early speed too. And there is Point Given. Point Given, a magnificent looking thoroughbred, standing 17 hands high. And he will stand in post position number 17 as he takes his place in the spot of the starting gate for the 127th running of the Kentucky Derby. The crowd starts to roar. We're ready for a start in the Run for the Roses. Talk as money was acting up just a bit in starting gate. And they're off in the Kentucky Derby. And Song and a Prayer comes in stride from his inside post. Balto Star is there, not far behind Millennium Wind. And here comes Keats from the far outside. Bias for the first time. And it is Song and a Prayer to lead the way. Balto Star right there with them. Keats on the outside is running along in third. Millennium Wind behind them fourth. Congaree is fifth. And Point Given is on the outside heading for the clubhouse turn. He's racing in sixth position now. And then it's Talk Is Money, seventh in between horses. Express Tour is a close to the pace ace. He's only about six lengths from the lead. Then it's a breakup. Five lengths now. Invisible Ink is ninth on the outside. Star Tech is running in 10th. AP Valentine is 11th. Thunder Blitz lumbering along in 12th place. Then it's a break of another three. Back to Monarchos. Dollar Bill followed on the inside by Arctic Boy. A break of six to Stretch Running Long Shots. 50 Stars in Jamaican Rum. They're 20 lengths from the lead. The opening half mile was the fastest in Derby history. 44 4/5 seconds. Song and a Prayer's pace is blistering down the backstretch. With 4.5 furlongs remaining, it's Song and a Prayer, and he leads by 2 lengths over Balto Star. Millennium Wind is now third toward the inside. Congaree in good striking position on the outside, and the pent-up power of Point Given. 5 lengths from the lead, he's beginning to advance. Express Tour is right with him as the field rounds the far turn. Then Invisible Ink, Thunder Blitz is well within striking range. Jorge Chavez gets busy on Monarchos, and they're surging as they move toward the top of the stretch, and Congaree has come away with the lead. Here comes his stablemate, Point Given, on the outside. They're in 3/4 in 109-1. Record time here in the Derby at the top of the stretch, and it is Congaree who is full out. Here comes Monarchos under a heavy drive on the far outside. Invisible Ink is there. Point Given, not today. 1 furlong left. Here comes Monarchos, who sweeps to the lead. He's pulling away by 2. He's pulling away by 3. Jorge Chavez and Monarchos have won the Kentucky Derby, and the final time was 1:59 4/5 seconds. He was as fast as Secretariat, and it was a photo for second there. Invisible Ink and Congaree as well. Absolutely thrilling. Jorge Chavez on top of the world. Jorge Chavez on top of the Kentucky Derby winner.
And John Ward, the trainer, celebrating a victory for the home.
And there's Bobby Frankel, and there is New York Hero. And breaking right next to him will be another New York Hero. Funny Side, the New York bred winner of the Kentucky Derby, A lot of action coming from those outside post positions. Peace Rules, of course, and Funny Side to the favorites here. And right there between them will be breaking New York Hero, who's a pretty speedy horse out of the gate. In the gate, final horse moving in. Senior Swinger on the outside with Pat Day aboard. Ready for the start of the 128th Preakness, and they're off. And Funny Side brush with New York Hero coming out of the gate. Down toward the inside, Scrimshaw's there. Peace Rules broke alertly, and Peace Rules remains in the middle of the track as they move by us for the first time. And Peace Rules will be the early leader. And a very eager Funny Side is outside to his inside at Scrimshaw as they race for the first turn here at Pimlico. And Cherokee's Boy pulls his way up into fourth position just inside the Derby winner. Then farther back, Kissin' Saint is now fifth on the inside, New York Hero racing sixth. And then it's Goodway Road, who's back in seventh. 10 Cents of Shine and Fufa's Warrior are racing eighth and ninth, and those two about 8 or 9 lengths from the lead, and a break of another five to the stretch-running Senior Swinger as the field races into the backstretch. Peace Rules, Funny Side, 1-2. The opening quarter was 23 1/5 seconds, a legitimate half mile of 47 flat. So it is Peace Rules, Edgar Prado rationing out his speed, tracked purposefully by the Derby winner, Funny Side. Midway Road makes a move as they approach the far turn, and he's now third, coming through on the inside. Scrimshaw back to fourth. Cherokee's Boy fifth on the outside with the half mile remaining. Then farther back, it's Fufa's Warrior getting in gear on the outside of New York Hero. Then a break of another three back to 10 Cents of Shine. Senior Swinger is launching his bid with 3 furlongs to go. And Funny Side now to the throat latch of Peace Rules. And the race is on as they approach the top of the stretch here at Pimlico. The field turns for home, and Funny Side comes roaring off the turn with the lead. Funny Side has repelled Peace Rules, and it's Scrimshaw on the outside, and he's now running in third. Midway Road is fourth toward the inside. They're in the final furlong now. Funny Side and Jose Santos turning the Preakness into a runaway. A huge effort here. It is Funny Side, and he's heading home. Back to Belmont. He's won the Preakness by almost 10 lengths. Back to Belmont for a date with Triple Crown Destiny. Midway Road got up to be second, and it was close for third there. What a tremendous effort. The final time over the good track here was 1:55.3. They came into the stretch. Funny Side just pulled away from Peace Rules like he was standing still, and he won by a huge margin, and he won with something left. We haven't had a Triple Crown winner in 25 years. We'll have to wait at least 3 weeks more.
Durkin's call.
And they're off in the Kentucky Derby. Imperialism got a little bump from the cliff's edge at the start. Read the footnotes, comes away in good order, and there's Lionheart flashing his early speed today. Minister Eric is up close to the pace. Limehost down toward the inside has been taken back. Quinton's Gold Rush in the far outside. Bias for the first time. Lionheart leads the way in a host of pursuers. Minister Eric is there. Read the footnotes is third. Smarty Jones very eager. He's fourth. Pollard's Vision is there on the outside, and Quinton's Gold Rush stacks six wide as they move into the clubhouse turn. Farther back, Master David is running along in seventh position. Borrego is eighth on the outside. Pro Prado moves up into ninth. Birdstone is 10th and in between horses. Limehouse is saving ground 11th. Castledale in the clear. He's now running in 12th. Friends Lake is now 13th. Song of the Sword is 14th. Tappet is running together 15th and 16th with the Cliff's Edge. And Imperialism is 17th. He has but one horse beaten, and that is action this day. The opening half mile, 46 3/5 seconds. And Lionheart throws down the gauntlet and opens up by three. Testing fractions for him, 5 furlongs to go. Smarty Jones is a stalking second as they approach the far turn. Pollard's Vision in the clear, and he's right there third. Minister Eric down on the inside moving from fourth. Read the footnotes is handling the track well. He's fifth between horses with a half mile to run. They run 3/4 in 1:11.4. Borrego's beginning to pick it up on the outside. Pollard's Vision threads his way through in between horses. And there goes Tappet. Tappet is circling horses on the far outside, and the Cliff's Edge is following him, and Imperialism is pisking his way through down toward the inside, not to the outside, and Master David follows him. They're 12 lengths from the lead as Lionheart turns for home, and undefeated Smarty Jones comes by off the turn, and these two hook up at the top of the stretch. Lionheart is all heart. Smarty Jones is all out, and those two deadlocked at the eighth pole, and Smarty Jones is rose.
race to the lead by journeyman jockey Stuart Elliott, and they have taken the lead away from Lionheart. Farther back, it's Limehouse and Imperialism, and here is the first undefeated winner of the Kentucky Derby since Seattle Slow in 1977. Smarty Jones has done it. What a moment this must be for Stuart Elliott. A 39-year-old journeyman, he has just won the race of a lifetime.